So you ever find yourself being lazy for no reason at all? Like you pick up your mail, you go in your house, you realize you have a letter for a neighbor. You ever just look at the letter and go, looks like they're never getting this. Take too much energy to go back outside. You might like stick it on a bureau. I'm gonna get that to them later on. Right now, I gotta watch some Love Connection. I got some new host on there. You ever have one thing to do all day, but you just can't get yourself to do it? I gotta go to the post office. But I'd probably have to put on pants. They're only open till 5. I'm gonna have to do that next week. Have a little more free time. I never have free time. Yeah, I don't know about you. Whenever I go to the... You ever go to the cash machine? There's two people in line in front of you. You get kind of flustered. You're like, forget it! I'm not standing here for 40 seconds. I got things to do, okay? Sometimes being lazy can get you in trouble, you know? Like, you ever not take a shower all weekend? Just lounging around, then you're running late for work on Monday? Oh, no. So is one person at work. Something smells like smoke in here. I went to a barbecue on Friday night. Only had 48 hours to take a shower.
Busy. A pool table, don't you understand? Friend, either you're closing your eyes to a situation you do not wish to acknowledge, or you are not aware of the caliber of disaster indicated by the presence of a pool table in your community. Well, you got trouble, my friend. Right here, I say trouble right here in River City. Why, sure, I'm a billiard player. Certainly mighty proud to say I'm always mighty proud to say it. I consider that the hours I spend with a cue in my hand are golden. Help you cultivate horse sense and a cool head and a keen eye. Did you ever take and try to find an ironclad lead for yourself from a 3-rail billiard shot? But just as I say, it takes judgment, brains, and maturity to score in a balk line game, I say that any boob can take and shove a ball in a pocket. And I call that sloth the first big step on the road to the depths of degrade. I say first, medicinal wine from a teaspoon, then beer from a bottle.
It's 7:08 at WRNJN Radio. I'm Don Rosen. Thanks for joining us. Bob Benson is here, one of the great actors at the Racine Theatre Guild in a lot of shows. How many shows have you been in there?
You know, I tried to figure that out this morning and I lost count. I think I'm in the upper 20s, I believe.
Wow, that's a lot.
Yeah, yeah.
Have you acted anywhere else besides the Theatre Guild?
I have. I've done a few shows up at Greendale Community Theatre. And yeah, that's the only other place.
Greendale. Nothing like at the Belasco on Broadway or...
No.
The Walter Kerr Theater on Broadway, nothing like that.
And nothing quite like that.
The Netherland Theater.
No.
Okay, nothing. I just want to see what theater you worked at before. Who'd you play in The Music Man?
I was in the ensemble in The Music Man. The Music Man is the first show that I did at the Racine Theatre Guild, so that's what kind of got me going here. That was in 2005. I did get a call back for that show, which is really exciting because it was the first thing I had done since high school. So on a whim, I auditioned. Actually, my son convinced me to audition. He wanted to audition himself, so he convinced me to take him. And as long as I was there,
you stole
he
the
convinced
part.
Me to. We were both cast, so we had a ball in that show. And yeah,
that is a fun show to do.
It really is.
And it's been on Broadway, I can't tell you how many times, because Hugh Jackman just had a huge run at the Winter Garden on Broadway. I think that's the only theater that's actually on Broadway. He was at the Winter Garden, and he was in The Music Man, playing Harold Hill, con man, and he did it real well.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that was your first show, and you were just in
in the ensemble.
Yeah, you were the ones just singing in the background.
Exactly.
Right. Yep. And that was at the Theatre Guild?
It was, 2005.
I find it so amazing. When I talked to Doug Incidence about this, I found it amazing. It's a horseshoe stage. It's not completely in the round. It's not a half thing. It's more like it's more than a half a circle. It's tough to do that because there's no curtain to come down to change the acts. Like on Broadway, where they bring the curtain down, all of a sudden they bring it up and there's a new set. Can't do it there. Everything's got to be right in front of everybody.
Right.
So they black it out, and they have people wearing black clothes. They look like little demons running around the stage. And they change everything around just to set up the show in itself, the directing of it. That's a big chore. And I know I have been to the Fort Atkinson Theater, and that's completely in the round.
Right.
But they have something clever that you guys don't have. They can bring the stuff hydraulics up from the basement and shoot everything up. So they can set something up. Now, it's not a big platform, but it's big enough where they can bring stuff up and people up so they don't have to run up and down the aisles. So, do you have any want to do any acting outside of, like, go to a big theater like in L.A. or Chicago or in, hate to bring it up, Broadway?
No, I mean...
You're good enough
Would I welcome that opportunity? Certainly, but it's not something that I actively pursue.
Did you ever...
You think I'm good enough for it?
Oh, sure.
I don't know about that.
We had... Tom Carco used to work here doing our news, and I said to him one day, I know people, friends of mine, who work at CBS and ABC Radio, because I started out with them. They're good. You're better than they are. And I'm telling you're better than they are, because I know these people. I know what they do, and I've heard... Now, they're all good. And one guy did the CBS Morning News for 20 years, and he's good.
Uh-huh.
But you're just as good or better than he is.
Well, thank
you. But
they
didn't believe it. You know, he doesn't believe he's better.
So. I don't believe I'm better.
Well, I'm telling you're better. You know, the best judge is the audience, not you. You know, sometimes I come out and say, oh, what a show today. I'm so embarrassed. I want to go hide. And somebody say, man, were you on the money today? Whoa. And then sometimes I come out of here and say, I feel so good. What a great show. Somebody come up. What's the matter? You had some gas today? Didn't feel well?
Yeah, right.
That's the matter. You had a bad day today? A little sick? Okay, so you started out. When did you get the bug? A teenager or?
I did do theater in high school.
Okay, here we go. That's actually
where I met my wife. We were in West Side Story together our freshman year of high school. I didn't necessarily fall in love with performing. I fell in love with the process. You just get an opportunity to meet so many crazy fun people, you know. So that's what really bit me. So then I did theater in high school, all 4 years of high school. And then, you know, you life takes over. You college, family, marriage, you know.
All those things get in the way.
Right. Certainly no time whatsoever for extracurriculars like theater. So I didn't do anything for, gosh, a number of years. Well, let's see. I graduated in 1983 to 2005. So that's too early for that kind of math in the morning.
Now, hold on. I can't write and talk at the same time. In high school, I didn't want to be in acting, but it looked fun. So one day, I got on stage. They had an audition for the show, whatever show it was. And I got up there. And three words came out of my mouth, and I knew it was terrible. Because I was watching the people before me, and I knew I wasn't doing what they were doing.
Mm-hmm.
And it was like one of those things from a chorus, like, next!
Next, right.
But I wound up for 3 of the 4 years in high school being a stage manager. So, you know, that was kind of fun. And I did some voiceover stuff when they needed an off voice from the... I could read things on a piece of paper, but I couldn't act them out. I just couldn't do that. So that was my big acting career in high school, just being stage manager. And it was fun. I did it for 3 years. I think I did a good job.
Sure.
But, you know, I just couldn't do that. I don't know how people act. Now, the movies, you get 20 times to do it right.
Right.
Maybe more.
Right.
But even still, you see people act on screen. They're good. But if you ever see behind-the-scenes video of how they do it, they do a little bitty part, little increments. They do two sentences, cut, and they redo the two sentences again and
exactly.
again and again.
You don't get that opportunity when you're performing live on stage.
You don't. So I have a few questions for you here.
Okay.
Have you ever forgotten a line on the show?
Oh, absolutely. So absolutely. Probably every show I've ever done, I've missed lines. Absolutely.
Now, the problem is the person who you're acting against is depending on you to remember that line because they can't say their line till they hear your line.
Exactly.
So what do you do?
So, I mean, eye contact is very important. we always say at the Guild, especially, it's a team sport. And it truly is. I mean, everyone's got to be on, and everyone has to be listening, and you know, you go through the journey together, and if somebody misses a line, and inevitably somebody misses a line, I mean, seriously, I have not been in a show where someone hasn't missed a line, but you're there, you're in it, and you're listening to one another, and you're all playing the same sport, so...
But, you know, and the audience won't know if you're missing a line.
Exactly.
They don't know.
They won't know unless you have the look of panic and you look around like, oh, God, somebody missed a line, you know. So
why is Bob sweating all of a sudden? Right. Is he having a heart attack up there? I see a lot of sweat coming from his
exactly.
We better call an ambulance. I would say to the person I'm acting, if you see me blinking wildly,
right.
I forgot my line. Keep going. How about this? Did you ever break out in a serious role laughing? Well, you couldn't stop laughing for some reason.
I have not done that. I certainly have broken character, but not in a serious moment like that. Fortunately, I have not come across a serious moment where I can't keep it together. So.
How about the audience? Does the audience ever screw you up? Where the cell phone thing must drive you nuts when they go, and they tell you before, shut your cell phone. And I don't know if people are just too old to listen to what was just said. They don't care. They said, oh, no one's going to call me. Don't worry. Then all of a sudden you hear the theme from The Godfather playing in the audience. Or worse, you hear some rap song playing with naughty words in it
coming
from the audience. Does that throw you at all?
I have certainly been distracted by it, but not to the point where I've, you know, lost my place and panicked and skipped a line or two, but that does certainly, the audience is a beast of their own, and that has a whole new dimension. But for the most part, I've been able to tone that stuff out.
You know, and also I would last 9 seconds because if somebody's phone went off, I'd look at them and say, "Hey, stupid, come here!" And I'd slap them in the face, bring them on stage, and insult them. Now they have done that on Broadway where the actors have stopped and say, "Give me that cell phone."
They have,
or they made fun of it.
Patti LuPone is famous for her stopping a show and yelling at an audience member. I don't have the ego that Patti has, so I have not done that just yet.
It's not an ego; it's just common.
You're trying
to perform. It's hard enough to do what you're doing.
Right.
And there's some morons got to play a cell phone because they couldn't shut it off.
I can't imagine not shutting my phone off after paying $300 to see a show.
That's right. You know, when I first started going to Broadway shows, they were $6 and $8. $6 and $8. Remember paying my first $125 mm-hmm. ticket, and now they're more than that.
Right.
Yeah, you go there, you want to make sure you enjoy the show.
Exactly.
Anyway, we're talking to Bob Benson, an actor at the Racine Theatre Guild. You do any other theaters now, or it's just Racine Theatre Guild?
Mostly just the Guild,
right.
Yep.
Racine Theatre Guild, or RTG, as our friends call them. We'll talk about some upcoming shows that he might be in. We'll tell you how to get into acting. We'll talk about some of his other shows. It's all coming up here at WRJN, 99.9 FM, 98.1 FM, 1400 AM. Hometown Radio Refreshed, a civic media station, 719.
God, you made many, many poor people. I realize, of course, that it's no shame to be poor, but it's no great honor either. So what would have been so terrible if I had a small fortune? If I were a rich man, all day long I'd biddy biddy bum. If I were a wealthy man, I wouldn't have to work hard. If I were a biddy biddy rich, idle diddle 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 man, I'd build a big tall house with rooms by the dozen right in the middle of the town. A fine tin roof with real wooden floors below. There couldn't be one long staircase just going up and one even longer coming down. And one more leading nowhere just for show. I'd fill my yard with chicks and turkeys and geese and ducks for the town to see and hear, squawking just as noisily as they can. And each loud...
What a classic show, Fiddler on the Roof. Every song in that show is a winner. There's no filler in there. And you starred in Fiddler as in the...
Ensemble. You know, when somebody asked me what I was in a show, and the answer to that is ensemble, I'm really proud of that, actually. It is not easy to be in an ensemble in a show. There's the phrase, there's no small part, but it's so true. The ensemble really carries a show and helps it move along. And the ensemble does not get a whole lot of individual rehearsal time. So a lot of that is work that they've done on their own. So, yeah, I have tremendous respect for people who are ensemble members and do nothing but ensemble work.
And I see them at the Guild all the time. There are certain people always in the ensemble, and they have to. There's a lot of moving around on stage. That's another thing. Two things. First of all, how do you remember lines? And what can you give young people a little clue on how to memorize the script? Because it's not a lot. I am here. I've been here for how many years? 24, a little more than 24 years. I still have to write down the lines I have to say because I can't remember them. And you've got a whole script you've got to remember. How do you memorize that?
It is difficult. I won't lie. And certainly the older I get, the more difficult it becomes. But there are some tricks to the trade out there. And many of them work. Some of them don't work for me. But I am a visual learner. So I literally visualize the script. And, you know, I can tell you what line is the third one from the top because I've put that in my brain visually. So that helps me a lot to picture that page.
Oh, I don't know how you do that. I just don't know.
I wouldn't say certainly it's a photographic memory, but there is something to that you can visualize that page of the script and that helps you remember.
Then you got to remember the song.
Then you have to remember the song and the choreography and yeah, it's a lot.
I didn't even get to the choreography yet. You've got to, because the light, the spots that come on the stage overhead, you've got to be underneath
them.
Hit
your mark, absolutely.
And they can't have too many marks on the stage because the audience is...
Looks like a landing strip out there. Right.
But they have all these places you have to be at an exact part of the song and the script.
And certainly most of the stuff that you see taped out on a stage that is a spike mark, that is for props and furniture. It's not for an actor to hit his mark. So you're right. I mean, there is a science to it. And it's not... It is easy, but it's not easy.
It's easy once you know how to do it.
It's easy.
It's like anything else. Like people say, how do you know where these buttons are? And I don't.
Exactly.
Just out of sheer years of hitting buttons, I know where they are.
Right.
But when I first came into my first job, I didn't know where they were. I just, I'm looking and making experiments. When you guys run off stage, when the different scenes, the characters have to leave, you run through the tunnel way there. What's on the other side? We always want to know where you're going.
at the Racine Theatre Guild, it's really a cool space. When you go down, we call them the VOMs. There is a walk around that wraps the entire circle of the stage, so you can go behind stage to, so you can go down and around and then come through a new entrance on stage. But it's probably maybe 10 or 12 feet wide. We store props down there.
And change
clothes, certainly.
Now,
sometimes, you've got 30 seconds to completely change your costume.
Now, do you get naked in front of people down there?
I have never gotten completely naked.
Everybody wants to know what's going on behind
them. We do. There are certainly circumstances where it's a requirement that, you are stripped down to your skivvies. But... when we're in a situation like that, we try to put up curtains and, provide privacy, certainly, for the actors. Usually, in a change like that, you've got somebody assisting you. So it happens quickly, and it's...
Well, I was backstage once. My dad fixed pumps for major buildings in New York. The water gets pumped up, but gravity brings it down. You got to get it up there. And he had a job, this one I used to work with him in the summer, was at the Palace Theater. And George M. in 1968 was on stage at the Palace with Joel Grey. And I went backstage because that's where the pump was having the problem. And it was during a matinee performance, so it was busy. And I was sitting there, and this guy backstage said, why don't you just have a seat over here? You can watch everybody doing everything, but just stay out of the way so they run real fast.
Sure.
It was chaotic. And this is a Broadway show. And I remember seeing Joel Grey and somebody just running around. And it was like, whoa. And you really, that's why he sat me down. You get in the way, you're going to be knocked down.
Exactly.
And they'll just step over you.
Right. Because there's no time to care if you got hurt.
Whoa. Mm-hmm. And this was a hit Broadway show, George M. It was, you know, went on for years. And then my dad came and I was terrified to walk because there wasn't even a stop. There wasn't a moment where it was just calm. It was just constant. People moving, running around. And not only the actors, but people doing the props, the stage. And
right.
Holy mackerel.
Yeah, there's a lot going on backstage at all times.
But not at the Guild.
Well.
Not that busy.
It depends on the show.
Now, do you have a backstage behind what we're seeing? We see that the back, the wall.
Right.
The set design is there a back behind that that's chaotic or what?
The actually behind, absolutely back behind that wall that you see in the back of the stage is our shop area where we build our sets and paint our sets.
They are magnificent. They are. So, I can't believe what a job the set designers do.
We've got some great designers
and the carpenters, whatever they build back there. And then the actual floor of the stage is redone for every show.
Every show. Yep.
What does the real floor look like?
I've never seen the real floor. in between shows, it gets painted black, so it can be a basic floor. But you're right. For every show, it gets a new facade.
It's about 3 inches higher.
It probably is about 3 inches higher from the paint
on there.
Exactly.
It's amazing. I've been going. I had season tickets for years and years. My mother, who grew up going to Broadway musicals, just couldn't wait to get to the Guild. She loved the shows there. Her favorite one was Glorious with Kathy Burr.
Glorious was an amazing production.
She quoted that show
that
all the time. She saw the original Funny Girl with Barbara Streisand on Broadway.
Oh.
But she said Glorious was her favorite show she ever went to. Yeah. It's 729 at WRGM. Bob Benson from the Racine Theatre Guild is here. We're talking about Broadway shows and the musicals and the plays they put on at the Guild and how they do it. We're getting a behind-the-scenes glimpse most people don't get. Keep it here. Hometown Radio Refresh, the Civic Media Station, 729 WRGM.
Best Buy has recalled nearly 300,000 air fryers after receiving complaints that they overheated, melted, or caught on fire. Overheated, melted, and caught on fire. Those are actually the options on the new Tesla.
An Australian billionaire, Clive Parker, has revived his dream to set sail on Titanic 2, a replica of the ill-fated ship that sank in 1912. And that's just like the original, with a traditional dining room, first-class dining saloon, luxurious staterooms and suites, grand ballroom, gymnasium, squash court, swimming pool, baths, theater, and casino. Yeah. I'm hearing a lot of words there that aren't lifeboats.
Edelweiss, Edelweiss, every morning you greet me.
They don't make CDs like they used to, do they? Actually, I think it's a CD player. We're going to fix that, and we're going to get to that song, because you sang that.
I did. That was, of course, from The Sound of Music. I was blessed to play Captain Von Trapp. And
that's a big role. That's like the lead.
Opposite Maria, but yes. Really, really beautiful show, beautiful music. The stage version is a little different than the movie version that we're all familiar with, but... still, you know, the same beautiful music. So, yeah, that was a special show to do. My niece actually played one of my children in that show. So that was a fun thing for me.
You know, I love going back, and they always go back to the children from the movie. Some of them aren't around anymore. But they had one who was, she went on a tour, and she was actually gave the tour in Austria to some of the places they filmed it.
Oh.
And they, I forget her name, Charmian? Is that her name? Charmian? She was one of the girls in the show.
Did she play Liesl?
Yes. No, not the little, that Liesl was a little girl.
Gretel was the little, Liesl was the oldest.
Yeah. I can't keep track of names. I'm lucky I remember my daughter and my son.
Right.
Anyway, so she helped give the tour which was really nice. Imagine having that on the Sound of Music tour. Kurt Vollman, who worked here for years, he went on the Sound of Music tour.
Oh, really?
Over in, yeah, he went there. Have you ever, do you see a show, the movie? Do you watch a movie before you do it at the Guild?
I mean, there was no way I could have avoided Sound of Music, but typically, no, I don't. I try not to do that before a show, just because I don't want to show up and copy somebody else's version of how they explored that character. So I try to do my own thing. Obviously, with Sound of Music, I couldn't avoid seeing that show first.
I did not see that until, like, in the mid-2000s, in the early 2000s. I had never seen it before.
Wow.
Our family wasn't movie musical people. We were Broadway musical people. We weren't movie musical people. So my mother had never seen that till she was, like, 88 years old, and she fell in love with it.
Wow.
Now all she did, I got her a copy of the movie, and she watched it at home over and over. Now, she did see Richard Chamberlain on Broadway do The Sound of Music. She was, quick funny story before we get some other questions here. So she's with my sister-in-law. They both live in New York. And she's at the tickets booth on Broadway where you can get the half-price tickets or last-minute tickets to a show. And they didn't have any left for The Sound of Music. And some guy said, I have two tickets here. You want to buy them? And my mother said, I'm going to buy those tickets from you. But if I find out that they don't work or they're not real, I will find you. And I will fix your wagon. So these better work. And it turns out they did work. But the lady in front of her online, she had tickets, and they didn't work.
Oh, no.
But my mother worked for the Department of Consumer Affairs for 21 years, so she knew how to handle people.
Sure.
But she actually said that. I said, well, I will find you. Because you come here a lot to
sell
tickets.
And I believe she would.
The movie, you know, I saw it, and we saw it, and Marcus Theaters ran it a couple of years ago with the intermission, the whole works. And I loved it. What a great, and I never watched it growing up. I just
that is that's the first movie in my childhood I can remember seeing in the movie theater. So that has always my whole life been my favorite movie. I don't know if it was because it was the first I ever saw, but that movie just it's absolutely my favorite movie. So for me to hear somebody who has not seen that movie is so foreign to me.
My first movie was Rodan versus Godzilla. I did see it in the movie. I saw Rodan in the theaters, but it was one of my first, but not my first. My first was Tammy and the Bachelor.
See, you remember your first movie,
I remember every movie I've ever seen and the theater I've seen it at.
Oh, wow.
I could name you any movie. Then I'll tell you the theater I saw it at, and I'll tell you who I saw it with.
I can only do that with my first, Don.
But I can't remember a city station. Okay, here's a couple of questions from our listening audience. What are you most proud of in your community involvement, both inside and outside of the theater?
Wow.
Do you get involved in anything outside the theater? Because it's a community theater.
It is a community theater.
And they don't pay, I don't think.
They do not pay.
Yeah.
There are certainly staff members who get paid. Doug has a salary.
Well, that's a full-time job.
Exactly. Yeah. Jocelyn is on the payroll. And our technical director, Jane, she is a paid position. But yeah, everybody else is a volunteer position. So I am very proud of my volunteer work at the Guild. It surprised me. I was there for a number of years. And my company that I work for Modine Manufacturing, they actually have a program where if you volunteer for any nonprofit organization, they will make a donation in your name. And I volunteered at the Guild for years, probably 10 years. And finally, our CEO stopped me in the hall one day and he says, hey, how come you never turn in your volunteer hours for your Guild, for working at the Guild? And it never dawned on me that that was a community service. You know, you think of, well, you have to serve food in a food kitchen or you're not providing, you know, something for your community. And it was sort of a light bulb moment when I realized, well, wait a minute, I am providing a service to the community.
You certainly
and,
are.
And yeah. So yeah, I turn in my hours now for that, and they make a donation in my name, and which is a wonderful program. I'm very proud of that. But
we look forward to going. We've been season ticket holders for 17, 18 years, maybe longer. And we look forward to every show. I put them on my phone so I don't forget, and I have the tickets in my drawer. And when it's coming up, we get so excited. because it's,
that's great to hear. Because you know, I do it because I love to do it, and I never consider what I'm doing for other people in doing so. That's just not part of it for me. But
well, I got to tell you, not just blowing smoke here, but it gives a lot of enjoyment. And I'm talking about the current show you just got done with in just a moment. The other thing was, we have our same three seats. My mother's no longer with us, but we still get the seat. I don't know why. I just don't want to give it up. But anyway, so we get the same three seats for the Broadway blockbuster thing you did recently. You weren't part of that, but it was the Spotlight show. Mm-hmm. We sat in different seats. You get a whole different perspective on the show. After having these same seats for decades, and when my brother and sister-in-law come, sometimes we have to change seats to get four in a row. It's a whole different theater when you sit in a different... It's like we're going to church. You sit in the same theater. Right. Then you move to the other side of the church, and all of a sudden, whoa!
This sounds completely different.
I never knew these people were on stage talking.
Right.
Let's talk about... I got one more question here I want to get to, because I'll forget. What's your internal process on taking up new theatrical projects? Now, I have the new... We had... Jocelyn Fish was on the air with us when we broke the news about the new season. Now, do you know if you're in any of these shows, or you just audition?
Absolutely not. Nothing is precast. Anything I'm interested, I will need to go and audition.
Do you still have to audition?
Yes, of course.
But they know what you do.
Yeah, but you can bring something completely different to a different role. So, yes, I audition for every role I've gotten. Yes.
So you're not going to be Cassius Clay.
I'm not going to be Cassius Clay.
So you're not going to be. My wife is looking forward to Little Women.
Little Women is a beautiful story. I'm not familiar with the
you
stage,
and I both.
The stage version, but it's a very popular show to produce. So I'm excited. I think the season has got a lot to offer. I'm really excited about the season.
The Murder on the Orient Express. The Theater Guild puts on shows that I already know, like Dial M for Murder. Mm-hmm. I've seen the Hitchcock movie a million times. I even saw it in 3D once. I've seen him a million times, so I know the ending. It was still fantastic. The guy who played the lead, they were all good, but the guy who played the lead and the inspector were standouts.
I agree with you completely.
They were standouts, but everybody was great.
Yeah.
But we know the ending,
right.
But it's still great,
but it's
to,
still
watch
great
it,
to watch it.
Because you have to see them how they get there in their version of it.
Right.
And Murder on the Orient Express, we've seen the movie. I can't wait to see it on stage. I want to see how you pull off the train thing on stage.
Right.
I want to see that. The other thing is Legally Blonde, the musical.
I'm really excited for Legally Blonde. I know that I shouldn't love that musical as much as I do, but it's just a fun, silly musical. It's very true to the film. With some great music added to it. So, yeah, I'm really excited. I actually did that show up in Greendale several years ago, played Professor Callahan, and had a ball with that. That was a lot of fun.
So how do you get your mindset for these shows? Do you have to get into character? Does everybody have to call you the character name back?
Right.
You always hear that in movies where you only call me by my character name.
Right.
Don't refer to me by any other name. You're not like that, are you?
I don't think they're... I'm definitely not like that. I don't know any people like that, fortunately. I think that's a bit much.
Who'd you play in Willy Wonka?
Willy Wonka.
Oh, you were Willy Wonka?
I was.
Because I
was
saw
fun.
That, and all I remember are... The bed was on stage, and the grandparents were in the bed. I recall that so much. You know, I actually have a movie prop from the movie, the original movie, Willy Wonka.
Really?
It's a tiny little thing, and it was something in one of the scenes. They had all these, whatever, the grass or something, and my son got me one of the pieces from the movie.
Cool. Did you see the new production?
No.
Wonderful.
You mean the movie?
The movie,
no,
yeah.
No.
It was really wonderful. It was a sentimental nod to the original, but expanding the story. But they treated the original with Gene Wilder with beautiful velvet kid gloves, and I loved it. My whole family loved it. We went in between Christmas and New Year's, and it was beautifully done.
I wanted to see Godzilla Minus One, but my wife didn't want to go see it. And by the time they took it out, now I can't see it.
Right.
But I did want to see Godzilla. I'm a big monster movie fan. I am all at home. Rodan, Gorgo, Godzilla. I got all the monster movies. I love watching those. And I know they're fake. I know it's a guy in a rubber outfit.
Right.
But
right.
It's still, I love it. Let's talk about, and we're going to have to take a break, but I'm going to talk on either side of it. Now and Then. Didn't know what it was when I went to see it. I said, oh, they're doing this dopey show Now and Then. Oh, let's go see it anyway. One of the best shows I've seen there.
Oh, thanks.
It was four people. That's all the show is for.
Right.
But I couldn't stop thinking about it. And the next day, my wife and I were still talking about it.
That's what I love to hear about that show, the conversations that it's sparked.
And it's done playing.
It's
so
done. So we can finally talk about it.
Yeah.
It was really hard to discuss the show because as soon as you start saying what the show is about, you give away the entire plot.
Yeah, you can't do that. Yeah. Although, when the lights blinked red when you came on stage, I had a feeling we were in some kind of warp. I didn't know. I had no idea what the show was about.
Mm-hmm.
And I saw the lights blink, and I said, something strange is going on here. And I picked up on it slowly. What a great show. Why don't you tell about the... we'll start talking about it now. Talk about the plot of the show.
Okay. So the show opens. The setting is a bar. Jamie is closing up for the night, and in walks this mysterious man who is willing to pay ultimately $2,000 to be able to stay in the bar and talk to Jamie and his girlfriend. You have absolutely no idea why he's there or why he wants to talk to them so bad.
He sounds like a weirdo.
He sounds like a real weirdo. Mm-hmm. Yeah. In fact, in the beginnings of the show, Doug introduced some very strange things that my character did just to try to throw the audience off, to keep them wondering about what in the world is this guy doing here. So as the story develops, we come to realize that the mysterious man is an older version of Jamie, who has come back to convince him to not follow through with his proposal that he has planned with his girlfriend that evening. And he's doing his darndest to get them to break up and to not follow the life path that he lived.
Hold it right there. I mean, I'm going to cry because I didn't think the show had a happy ending. I didn't walk out feeling great when it was over. I said, oh. And you start thinking about, what if I went back in time? What would I do?
Right.
Hold on. We're going to continue talking about that with Bob Benson, one of the stars of Now and Then, which just played at the Guild. It's over now, so we can tell you the plot points. It's 7:49 at WRJN Radio, hometown radio refreshed, a civic media station. Stay right where you are. More coming up with Bob in a moment.
Begun at last, this change. Can people really fall in love so fast? What's the matter with you, Cosette? Have you been too much on your own? So many things unclear, so many things unknown. Questions and answers that somehow seem wrong. In my life, there are times when I catch in the silence the sigh of a faraway song, and it sings of a world that I long to see out of reach, just a whisper away, waiting for.
Such a lonely child.
That's from Les Miserables. And you had two different roles in that, not at the same show, but you played two of the major parts in that show.
At the Guild, I played Jean Valjean, which is the father in the show. And yeah, beautiful, beautiful show. I'm so proud of that show. And then I had an amazing opportunity to play Javert, his arch nemesis in the show, in at Greendale Community Theater. So yeah, I got to play both the good guy and the bad guy.
I cried.
It was fun. I cried too.
I cried. I cried a lot of movies. I cried at Field of Dreams. I cried at. I was in the theater going, at the end when his father takes off his mask. People say, what's the matter with that man? But there were other people tearing up too.
Sure.
And not women. There were guys tearing up. I don't know why. Field of Dreams.
I cried every show of Now and Then. I mean, those were real tears. If you saw the show, yeah, those were real tears.
Yeah, let's talk more about that. So it turns out, where you left us off here, you are a... The kid at the bar, you are him.
An older version of him.
Years
right,
and years later, right. And you've seen what the future holds.
Exactly. And I mean, he lived his life and not without duress, and he wanted to change some things, and he wanted to convince his younger self to not go through with proposing to his girlfriend, Abby, and live a different life than what he lived. He had children. One of them joined the Marines after 9/11, and they lost him in that conflict. And he came back to convince his younger self not to go through with it, so that he could change the course of his life. Which, as the story unfolds, he's not a very likable person, and I would imagine as an audience member, you're thinking, what was so horrible, and you know, why is he trying to change all of this? Well, you come to realize that he's actually doing it because he's realized that he has killed Abby's spirit, and he's trying to figure out a way that he can give her a better life, and he realizes the only way that he can do that is to provide her a life without him. So
it was
such a brilliant script.
How come we never heard of this before?
I don't know. The playwright, the Guild did a show, the playwright show last year, which in my opinion was an amazing show as well. That was, oh gosh, I'm going to forget the name, Don. It was about the heart transplant.
Yes.
The Tin Woman.
Yes, they had a Q&A after the show.
Yes.
We were talking about the actors, yeah.
A beautiful script. And
same person?
Same playwright.
Whoa.
Yeah.
Okay.
So with the popularity of that show, and it, as much as it was recognized what a beautiful script that was, the play reading committee for this season read another one of his shows, being Now and Then, and so chose
that
again. Oh,
it was so good. And here's the thing, I had a question for you. Because we weren't 100% sure. When you went back to present day at the end,
mm-hmm.
they went through. Did you know you went back in time?
Yes.
So you were aware that
we
you
were
changed
aware
everything.
That it, in fact, the night that you saw at the end of the show was the same night that we went back 30 years earlier, 35 years earlier. There was a line about where Abby asks him, "Do you know what tonight is?" And this is the night that we went back.
Oh, see,
in time.
I didn't know
yeah.
that.
Yeah.
Would you have an Apple Watch to send you back? What was that device?
Right. iTime, they were calling it. It was an early version.
I would never, ever want to go back in time, because there's an old saying, if you change one grain of sand on the Sahara, you change the world forever.
Right.
And I wouldn't want to change anything, because I wouldn't meet my wife. I wouldn't have my daughter.
It's
like Back to the Future.
Exactly.
When he can't screw up.
Yeah.
Because he did change everything. His geeky father became an author of Star Wars.
Right. Right.
So it was such a meaningful show to think about.
Yeah.
I love that show. And I would love, they can't do a movie version of it, only four people in it. But, oh, wow, that was so good. And you guys did a wonderful job.
Thank you.
Everybody was perfectly cast.
Yeah. You asked me earlier what I was most proud of. That is one of the things, one of the roles. I mean, I've had so many blessings in my almost 20 years at the Guild. And I've been given some amazing opportunities. But Now and Then is definitely going to go up there in my memory for being one of the greats.
Quickly, in the last minute or so here, advice to young people. There are a lot of people that say, I want to be a movie star. I want to be an actor. What advice do you give them?
I mean, I would tell people follow their dreams. You know, it's so cliche, but it's so true. If you have a dream, by all means, follow that dream. Open yourself up to opportunities. You'd be surprised at the things that you can be open to. So, yeah, pursue it. Absolutely.
Up to my mother's dying day, she said, "Are you going to be a disc jockey all your life?" Now, at that point, I was in it for over 50 years. Is this really what you're going to do?
I'm thinking yes.
Really? Because your brother's a doctor. And, you know, Bob Bent, I got to have you back. I got another 3 or 4 hours with you.
Oh,
thank you very much. I can't wait to see what shows you're going to be in the new season.
I'm excited.
Ain't going to be one of the little women.
Nope, you're right about that.
But you never know. Nice dress, long
right,
wig.
Right.
Bob, thank you very much. You gave me so many hours of entertainment. I do appreciate it.
Thank you so much for having me.
All right. Back tomorrow morning, 6 a.m. Bright and early here, or dark and early. WRJN, Hometown Radio Refreshed, a Civic Media Station.